afternoon, everyone. I'm Jocelyn Bowling Dixon, director of the Newark Public Library. Martin Luther King once said, if you can't fly, then run. If you can't run, then walk. If you can't walk, then crawl. But whatever you do, you have to keep moving forward. In that spirit, I welcome you virtually to the library's annual Martin Luther King Jr. commemorative lecture. As I am sure all of you were, I was looking forward to attending the lecture in person this year, but we are also grateful for the technology that allows us to gather safely today to honor Martin Luther King's tireless work and legacy, despite the current circumstances and ongoing challenges of the pandemic. So a few thanks. I'd like to thank you to Dale Colston, our supervisory librarian of the James Brown African American Room, and also to Eric Royce from our IT department for the nimble pivot to a virtual program. Special thanks to the PNC Foundation for its ongoing support of our annual Black History Celebration and programs such as this lecture. Lastly, I also want to thank our guest lecturer for her grace and flexibility, and to all of you in the digital universe for joining us. And now I'll pass it to Dale. Dale?
Thank you, Jocelyn. We are also joined here today by two fabulous ASL interpreters, Nicole Schamburger, Pamela Collins. Thank you. Carrie Pogue joined the New Jersey Division of Deaf and Hard of Hearing as Program Coordinator for Language and Instruction in December 2019. She's been a mentor to deaf students and was a deaf paraprofessional at Galloway Township School. She was the president of the oldest New Jersey Deaf Social Club, the Atlantic County Society of the Deaf, which was founded in 1966. Carrie attended Gallaudet University in Washington, D.C., and is a board member of the ASL program at Camden County College. Please join me in welcoming Carrie Pogue.
Hello. I'm Carrie Pogue, and I am the coordinator of the Language Instruction Program for the Human Services Division for the Deaf and Hard of Hearing. I'm speaking today on behalf of the Executive Director, Elizabeth Hill. Elizabeth regrets that she is unable to be with us today. DDHH is delighted to be a part of today's virtual Martin Luther King Jr. commemorative lecture. This is to honor the legacy of the legendary civil rights leader, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. DHS sees the long-lasting effects of Dr. King's mission, a mission of bringing greater equality to all people in our greater nation, and understand more work is still needed. So we see his legacy continue in Claudia L. Gordon, the first Black deaf female attorney in the United States. Ms. Gordon has cultivated a career dedicated to helping individuals with disabilities and has worked to bring greater inclusion and equity on the federal level under the Obama administration. DHS is truly inspired by Ms. Gordon, and we are honored to hear her speak later today. At DDHH, we are dedicated to helping deaf, hard of hearing, and deafblind individuals. We work to bring greater equality and access for our deaf and hard of hearing residents, through programs and services focused on training, education, outreach, and direct services. We look forward to continuing our work and ensuring our deaf and hard of hearing residents live full and fair lives. And we, again, are delighted to do so as we celebrate this very important day. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Carrie. Much continued success to you and to the staff at the Division of the Deaf and Hard of Hearing. Often referred to as the Black National Anthem, Lift Every Voice and Sing was a hymn written as a poem by NAACP leader James Weldon Johnson in 1900. His brother, John Rosamond Johnson, composed the music for the lyrics. A choir of 500 school children at the segregated Stanton School, where James Weldon Johnson was principal, first performed the song in public in Jacksonville, Florida, to celebrate Abraham Lincoln's birthday. Here to perform it today via video are Miss Annette and Miss Audrey of His Hands Choir. Thank you. President of the Newark Public Library's Board of Trustees. She is an educator, researcher, and community organizer who focuses on education equity and school transformation to support and elevate Black and Brown students and their community. As director of the Metropolitan Center for Urban Education at NYU, she led an initiative called the Newark Global Village School Zone. She has also served as Chief Education Officer for Mayor Raz Baraka. In 2016, Lauren founded Creed Strategies, a group of consultants who use their knowledge, experience, and resources in collaboration with educators and communities to enhance learning conditions for children and teachers. She holds a BA in English from Temple University, an MA in Educational Leadership from Teachers College, Columbia University, and a PhD in Education Policy from the University of California at Los Angeles. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Lauren Wells.
Thank you for the introduction, Dale. And before you go, well, you went very quickly. I also just wanted to say thank you for this very special Dr. Martin Luther King commemorative lecture, and for pulling a discussion together today that lives at the intersections of the work of equity, justice, diversity, and inclusion. I am thrilled to be here to introduce our guest lecturer this afternoon, Claudia Gordon. I spent some time Googling her and looking at her many accomplishments, and it is insufficient to say that she has opened doors and given voice and visibility to people with disabilities at all ages. And I am just humbled to have the honor to sit here with you on Zoom and take in your grace and your composure and your beauty, and to spend this time learning from you. So without any further ado, Claudia Gordon is a dedicated advocate for people with disabilities who specializes in creating a world that allows them to feel seen, heard, valued, and included. Born in Jamaica, West Indies, she became deaf at the age of 8. She was able to move to New York so that she could attend a school for the deaf and learn sign language. She then graduated from Howard University, for all you bisons out there, at American University's Washington College of Law, becoming the first deaf African-American female attorney. During her nearly 30-year career, she has held senior leadership positions with the National Council on Disability, the National Association of the Deaf Law and Advocacy Center, and the U.S. Department of Homeland Security. Claudia served in the Obama administration as the chief of staff for the U.S. Department of Labor's Office of Federal Contract Compliance Programs and as associate director of public engagement for the White House Office of Public Engagement. Currently, she is senior accessibility strategy partner with T-Mobile's diversity, equity, and inclusion team. In this role, she manages enterprise-wide strategies that support a disability-inclusive culture as an accessible, equitable work environment. Her efforts have been recognized by many organizations, including the American Association of People with Disabilities, National Black Deaf Advocates, and the Route 100. I give you Claudia Gordon.
Thank you so much for that introduction. And thank you for the invitation. Thank you for your remarks, DDHH. And I appreciate the representatives from the library who've contacted me to speak to you today. It is truly an honor to speak to you on this Martin Luther King celebration. Of course, under normal circumstances, I would have been in Newark, New Jersey with you. I would be there with you today, in person, delivering my remarks. But I wanted to let you know that I'm having issues with my internet, and I'm hoping that my internet will cooperate with us today so that I can get through this presentation. Again, thank you, everyone. I appreciate all of you taking your time to join us this afternoon for the presentation as we honor Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Again, I'll say, under normal circumstances, I would be with you, but unfortunately, I'm not today. But we're recognizing that we are living in unprecedented times. As a society, we continue to grapple with COVID-19, the pandemic. And I'm sure all of you at this point have had a number of experiences during this time. And we haven't experienced such a thing in our life as this in our lifetime. We've experienced a loss of life, a loss of loverhood, economic stability, isolation, fear, uncertainty, and all of these things have impacted many of us in Black and Brown communities. And the issues have compounded for those individuals particularly, and also individuals with disabilities. And so simply put, I will just say that we are living in unprecedented, challenging times. In addition to the prolonged global pandemic, and also all of us who've had to kind of stay in our homes and not socialize with one another. When we look back at the year of 2020, we think of the political divide, climate change, things that have happened in the nation that has looked to get the attention of all individuals, spotlighting the police shootings on unarmed Black men and women. I've mentioned this, but as you know, I am an optimist. I am always looking at this glass that is half full and seeking to find that silver lining in times of hardship, setback, and challenges. When I think about Amanda Gorman and her poem that she lamented, when we consider the opening lines during that inauguration, it was entitled, "The Hill We Climb." If you would remember an opening line from that poem, which says, we ask ourselves, where can we find light in this never-ending shade? The loss we carry, a sea we must wade. But more importantly, in closing, she reminded us that there is always a light if only we're optimistic, and I'm sure each of you are, and if we're brave enough to see it. If only we are brave enough to be it. And so that includes you, if you are brave enough to be it. And also, Martin Luther King Jr. reminded us in his final manuscript, which he penned in 1967, while isolating himself from the demands. But I also have to let you know that at that time, he had to isolate himself so that he can write the manuscript. Thinking about, I think about what's happening with me, how sometimes I have to isolate myself when I consider those things that are happening in my homeland of Jamaica. And so in the manuscript, he mentions the demands that he experienced. And in that movement, it says, the first, the line of progress is never straight. For a period, the movement may not follow a straight path and encounters obstacles, and the path bends. It's like curving around a mountain as you're approaching the city. Often it feels as though you're moving backwards and you lose sight of your goal. But in fact, you are moving ahead as soon as you see the city closer by. And so as you trail along the way, you will see that city. In the short life that Dr. King lived, he helped us move closer to those ideals on which America, this country, was founded. He challenged us to make the real promise of America as a land of freedom, equality, opportunity, and brotherhood. And that promise was brought forth to us from our ancestors. And when I think about my family coming from Jamaica, we look to achieve that promise. And as we continue to celebrate today, and we remember the days of old, we remember those things that we fought to continue here in America, which are freedom, equality, opportunity, and brotherhood. And speaking as a Black deaf woman, I often observe just a moment, I'm checking in with my interpreter, but we're okay. again, as a Black deaf woman, I often observe the convenient mistake of groups or leaders approaching these struggles from a very narrow framework, or what I would refer to as those identity silos. Oftentimes, groups work in silos. They aren't working with one another. And so in this, we see struggle. But if we are able to embrace those struggles together, then we as a collective group can succeed. And so I'm sure you're wondering what I mean by that. If we are able to embrace the diversity that exists within our communities, then we, of course, cannot take up a cause for some while leaving others out. That approach, the silo approach, is counter to Dr. King's teaching. He taught us that injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. And so to put that quote in context, let us use the topic of police brutality. We think about police brutality, criminal justice reform and the criminal justice system, the Black Lives Matter movement. But I'm sure you often notice that there is little visibility given to the fact that these issues don't include individuals from the disability community, when in fact, 30 and even 50% of those individuals who are unnamed Black and Brown men and women who were killed by police are individuals with disabilities. And so rarely does a Black disabled advocate or activist get involved and share the stage with Black civil rights leaders and activists demanding criminal justice reforms. So this is kind of what I mean when I talked about those silos and focusing on one issue items. Those conversations and causes should consider individuals and their intersections. And going back to the teaching of Dr. King is something that we should keep in the forefront. And so these conversations and causes must be expanded to include issues such as the need to channel more resources to underserved communities to better address mental health conditions, to provide awareness, crisis intervention training to law enforcement, and also, when we consider those protests, they should also support families with members who have cognitive disabilities. And also considering these individuals when responses are made. And so each individual should be involved in the conversation, and this doesn't happen often. Instead, what we're actually seeing is that those issues are largely set aside as some individuals are struggled to deal with specific issues while some communities are often pushed aside. And so basically, the disability community leaders and organizations should be included, but they aren't. But meanwhile, those of us who are in the Black and Brown disabled communities, we continue to call out disability rights movements for being too white, right? And we, of course, decry the fact that we are not represented. We're not at the table. We're not involved enough. We're not in the boardroom. And that our issues and concerns are inadequately addressed. It's almost like, you know, living in no man's land, right? Activist Angela Davis. I was reading her book, and it's entitled, "The Freedom is a Constant Struggle." It discusses the concept of intersectionality of struggles, wherein she asks the question, how do we bring various social justice struggles and movements together, whether we consider race, class, gender, sexual orientation, again, going back to those silos, how can we ensure that each community works together and not work on their own one specific issue, but work on the issues of the entire community? And so as we take on this work and consider what we need to do, we have to consider the accountability and justice for all. And we also must consider inclusion of individuals and their intersections. Common connections are vital, of course. And we are more alike than we are different. I'll just say that I'm deaf, I'm disabled, and I'm also Black. And so as I share my story, I could do this in just sharing my story with you. But also, I can share stories from a number of perspectives. I think about my experiences being the only Black deaf person at a university. I could talk about that, but I'll save that story for another time. But I can give you an example about being at the table when discussions are had in terms of gender pay and pay equality. And throughout that time, when I worked in the Obama administration, that was one of the issues that we championed and fought for, the gender pay and equity gap. And so when I showed up at the table to have this discussion, of course, others were looking at me, wondering, you know, is she an imposter? Because they didn't expect me, a Black deaf woman, to have a seat at this table with them. And ain't I a woman? And so I thank our beloved ancestor, Sojourner Truth, for that phrase, ain't I a woman? I am a champion for disability rights, but I am equally passionate about a number of issues that impact women, racial justice issues, and issues that impact Black and Brown individuals. And so that's what I mean. There are some commonalities and common themes that we fight for. But before I move on, let me close this topic of intersectionality by saying representation matters. And not just it matters when it matters to a particular group in that moment, our voice, our perspectives matter. And so for leaders out there, when you take up a cause, whether it be voting rights, immigrant rights, LGBT rights, healthcare, women's rights, education, employment, please, begging you at this moment, I'm pleading for you to make room for us at the table, individuals with disabilities. Disability should not just be a word added among a list of other marginalized identities that a movement claims to represent, but for which substantial dialogue and allyship are missing. It's more than just an add-on reference. Include the voices, include our perspectives. You see, when we think about the disability community, 15% of the world's population, which is 1 billion people worldwide, have some type of disability. Those numbers are significant. And so you may consider disabled community as one minority group, but that's not the case. Definitely, this group has expanded over time. And so to include those individuals in your discussion. And so when you include us, you're telling people with disabilities that they are not outsiders and are not seen as others in their otherness. You are actually inviting us to live in greater dignity as empowered individuals who add value. And we add this value, whether it be economic value or value to lives in the community. And so for those of you who are joining today, I want you to show up for change to happen. We must step out of our comfort zone. We have to find that courage from within and go ahead and take up those spaces where you rightfully belong. And in those spaces, oftentimes, my fellow disabled persons, you felt like you were not welcome. And so I want you to find the courage to take up your space. Allow your voices to be heard. I've learned that we can't be an activist of change if we continue to allow those barriers that are in front of us stand in our way on their turf. While the disability movement has made some enormous strides in the past, we think of over 30 years. We remember what has happened in the past. We remember the protests that have happened. But some of these things have still not altered the hearts and minds of individuals. And individuals with disabilities are still not included in the dialogue. Oftentimes, those laws and policies are outdated. And some of those standards are outdated as well. And so, just wanted to check in with my interpreter to make sure we're okay. Seems we are on the same page, so I'll keep going. Many still don't understand disability issues as civil rights issues. There are attitudinal barriers as well, and those continue to hinder our advancement, the advancement of people with disabilities. The perceptions and the attitudes towards people can sometimes be disabling and more disabling than the actual disability itself. Discrimination against people with disabilities takes on many forms. But if we were, for instance, to examine a number of spaces in terms of employment, we can see the devastating impact of discrimination. And so at any given time, when I consider the work that I've done in the disability community and with disability rights movements, when I consider our work and the unemployment rate of individuals with disabilities, it's almost double the rate of those individuals without disabilities. And even more discouraging, per the Department's Bureau of Labor Statistics data on individuals working age with disabilities, currently roughly 22% of people with disabilities are in the labor force altogether. And so you remember now, that's an employment rate. And so that rate, when you compare it to individuals without disabilities, it's 67%. And so when we look at 22% of those individuals who are working, and then also those without disabilities are almost 70%. So look at the staggering difference between those two figures and consider that. And so when we think of employment in the context of Dr. Martin Luther King and his work, we understand the simple truth that social justice without economic security is meaningless. Civil rights must come with real economic opportunity. Otherwise, they're just words on a piece of paper. And now, 58 years later, after the passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, 48 years after the passage of the Rehabilitation Act of 1973, and 31 years after the passage of the American with Disabilities Act, for many in the disability community, the dream is still just a dream. And so when ADA was passed, it had an intention that all of those barriers would be broken, that all of the walls of shame and discrimination that marginalize individuals, roughly, I would say, 4 to 6 million individuals with disability, actually 54 million individuals with disabilities. Those people living towards independency, self-sufficiency, personal autonomy, all of these individuals across the country depend on economic security that comes from employment opportunities, right? But far too many people are still finding those doors of employment opportunities shut in their face. And now with COVID, the impacts are more compounded. These individuals are last to hire and first to fire. Now, I'm speaking generally for the disability community as a whole, not the Black and Brown community. But because the numbers, if I spoke of Black and Brown disabled people, the narrative would be more troubling because of the compounded injustices streaming from multiple marginalizations. As a Black woman who happens to be deaf and an immigrant, my career journey is no small feat. I am so thankful that I was determined to disrupt the status quo. I pushed back towards those low expectations and I walked into rooms where I was viewed as an imposter, as an outsider, and I experienced many forms of microaggressions. I fought a number of battles in terms of reasonable accommodations. And thinking about the juxtaposition of excess and confronting those ignorances of discrimination. And so again, I fought a number of battles in terms of reasonable accommodations. And so oftentimes we find ourselves in situations where we have to advocate for ourselves. And of course, it's a very difficult line to navigate. People often marvel at my achievement. I find it important to remind them that I am not someone who achieved the impossible, but rather an example of what people with disabilities can achieve if they are given the fair chance to achieve. They, of course, like me, can go as far as they want to go. And with their hard work as well, it would take them far. And so, of course, these individuals could lead the work. And so remembering, again, I'm just one person, but you should consider individuals with disabilities as your example, realizing that individuals with disabilities can do these things. I am just one example of those individuals within a collective group of individuals. These individuals, of course, have a plan and a strategy for moving the needle forward if they are given the opportunity to do so. Give individuals with disabilities the opportunity to fail or succeed based on the strength of their work ethic and the scope of their dreams, rather than artificial accessibility and attitudinal barriers. Of course, I didn't achieve the impossible. There are so many people out there who came before me. And of course, there are another individuals with disabilities who are just as smart as I am, just as capable as I am, just as ambitious as I am. But unfortunately for them, they haven't been given the opportunity. And a number of them have just given up because of all of the challenges that they face. And so I guess I'll move on from that point. I wanted to stress again that we are living in some unprecedented, challenging times. Now more than ever, we need to lean on each other. We need to be an ally. It's not enough for some of us to get ahead when so many are barely getting by. So let's identify ways, as Dr. King did in leaving his legacy. It was a challenging time for them, and we are also living in challenging times. So let us identify ways that those individuals around us, whatever privilege that we have, making sure that we expand the circle of inclusion and to bring those individuals, like I've done and like I want you to do as well, bring those individuals who are on the margins. Pull them into the center of things. Pull them into the forefront. I am hopeful. I know I've talked a lot about struggle, but I am hopeful. And again, I am an optimist. I always think of that glass half full. And so I know the past 2 years for us, members of the disability community, has been rough. We've experienced some challenging times, but we've also had a number of wins. And so there is a lot of work that's left to do, but at the same time, there are things to consider that we've accomplished. And so we think about 2020, when George Floyd was murdered. We think about the issues in terms of diversity, equity, and inclusion. Oftentimes, individuals are not included in the dialogue. We say diversity, equity, but inclusion often is not the priority. Strategies are set that do not include individuals with disabilities. But we have to consider that individuals with disabilities are included in our inclusion discussions. And so a number of corporations here in America have often overlooked individuals with disabilities, but now they're taking proactive steps to include individuals in their plans. Like, for an example, I work for T-Mobile. And the work that I'm currently doing with T-Mobile, I am the senior accessibility strategy partner for the company. And I took that role in 2021. And so making sure that disability is woven into all of the work that the company does is a priority. Making sure that disability is a part of that discussion is important as well. Changing the culture of the corporation to include disability, equity, and inclusion aspects. And so, as a result of that work, I have seen progress. And I'm really excited about the future and what can happen. When we think about individuals who are in film, like in Hollywood, for example, we're seeing a number of deaf individuals who have been involved in Marvel films. Being a superhero, getting that spotlight is something that we'd like to consider seeing. And so when we think about what all of this means for a young child who's deaf, whether there be a girl or boy, they're able to see representation on the TV screen in roles such as a superhero. Imagine what seeing that type of person would do for them. And so when I think back to my own childhood, I realized back then as a deaf child, I was made to feel like there was no purpose for me in life. But now I'm grateful for the representation that we are seeing. I'm grateful for doors that are opening for us and that are continuing to open. Deafness has become normalized in a sense. It's not a group of individuals that are not included in society. And so again, I am hopeful. And in these times that we live in right now, that we continue to move forward, that we continue to rely on one another, that we continue to embrace our intersections, to look at the differences and the struggles and the challenges that we have, but still work together. So in closing, and I'd like to close up my remarks for the day, I would like each of us to be a vehicle for change. And each of us to help amplify the voices of those who are not often heard. We should support these individuals in any situation. And again, as Dr. Martin Luther King said, this is one of his quotes. It says, "A man hasn't started living until he can rise above the narrow confines of his existence to the broader concerns of all humanity." And so with that, I'll close my remarks for the day. Thank you very much for DDHH. Thank you for the team who has worked on our efforts today. Thank you for your flexibility in pivoting to a virtual presentation today. I wish you all of the best in your work. I thank you so much for your participation in our session today. And I want everyone to be safe and remember that Monday we celebrate the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Day. It's a day on and not a day off. It's a day of service. So go out and serve. Take care, everyone.
Thank you ever so, Sister Gordon. That was inspiring. We all have a lot of work to do. We hope our community here in Newark and specifically at the Newark Public Library that we continue in this work with you of inclusion, acceptance, and diversity. We do have one question, and it seems to be about labels or self-identification. And a gentleman asks, am I wrong to find the term brown to describe me as a person insulting because I do? So he seems to be insulted by the term brown as an identification.
No, you are not wrong. Identity is personal. It's based on an individual. And so if I have offended you in my use of that title, then I sincerely apologize. You know, I try to be inclusive, and often in doing so, when we're talking about Black individuals, I find that we used it so often. What about the Latino community? What about Native Americans? What about our other brothers and sisters who are also facing those same marginalized disparities that we do? The same things that we confront. When it comes to police brutality, it's not just the Black community. I mean, there's an entire spectrum from Black to brown. And so for want of a better term, I typically use Black and brown with the goal of being inclusive. But at the end of the day, identity is very personal. And so that's a discussion that we could have. I could go on, and I have it every day within the deaf community. There's some individuals that don't want to be called or labeled as disabled. There are people that don't have disabilities, and they feel uncomfortable using the term, when in fact, there's a movement happening right now that's called Say the Word. Just say it. Just say disability. Stop coming out with these labels, creative labels like the abled or special needs. Or, I mean, I could just come up with a host of other terms that that the community is trying to come up with. But just use it. But going back to your comment, honor what you feel. Go with what you feel. How you choose to identify yourself is very personal. I know that there was a time when I never did consider myself with the label deaf because I grew up marginalized. I didn't grow up marginalized, right? Initially, in my formative years. And I'm sorry, the frame is freezing just a bit. And I know, people would say, oh, you have a hearing problem. I would tell them, I have a hearing problem. Or I would say, I can't hear you very well. I thought of any title I could come up with without saying I'm deaf. I wouldn't use that label. And so that's been a journey for me. My own personal journey. And today I've arrived at a place, right? And so my long answer is that yes, you are not wrong to feel that way at all. It is a personal journey, and it's based on individuals. Thank you for sharing that.
Thank you. And we have lots of comments in our chat. You're truly an inspiration, Ms. Gordon. Thank you for sharing your insights. Awesome lecture, thank you. Excellent speech, thank you. What a gracious and inspiring lecture. So again, we thank you very much here at the Newark Public Library for sharing your time with us this afternoon. Thank you, thank you. Thank you ever so to our 2022 Dr. King lecturer, Claudia L. Gordon. Again, it was an honor to welcome you. And thank you to today's fantastic interpreters for today, Pamela Collins and Nicole Schamburger. Thank you, Carrie Pogue from the State of New Jersey's Division of Deaf and Hard of Hearing. Heartfelt thanks to His Hands Choir for the moving rendition of Lift Every Voice and Sing. We could not have done this without the funding from the PNC Foundation. We appreciate your continued support of the Newark Public Library's Black History Celebration and associated programs. I wish to thank my colleagues behind the scenes, Tyson Haley, our program and events coordinator, Alicia Grant, my JBAR colleague who provided graphics, Eric Royce from our IT department, Karen Horton of the development department, and Ingrid Betancourt, Assistant Director for Special Collections, for her guidance and continued support. Eric, we have a video, a flyer. We could share that now. Thank you. Through the month of February, we'll continue to take precautions, and we will again be virtual on February 2nd. Please join us for the kickoff of our Black History celebration. We'll welcome author, food historian, and activist, celebrity chef Michael Twitty. Our 2022 Black History celebration will be about food and food culture. We'll examine African origins of the food that we eat here in the United States, the history of soul food, food apartheid, the Black Panther Party's free breakfast program, the current and future state of Black farmers here in the United States, restaurants, and lots more. Please plan to join us. So on behalf of Jocelyn Bowling Dixon, the director of the Newark Public Library, and Dr. Lauren Wells, president, Library Board of Trustees, we thank you all for joining us this afternoon. This program has been recorded and will be available for review on the library's YouTube page very soon. Thank you again, and be well.